I'm going to be using my staking tool set to close the pivot holes on a pocket watch. Closing pivot holes was a regular practice on watches with a low number of jewels. It was a common job that the watchmaker had to perform almost daily. Sometimes you had to do it several times a day. If the pivot holes are too large, you're going to have a loss of power and that watch won't run well. More likely, the watch will be running slow. It won't be keeping good time. Now here's the brass plate that we'll be closing the hole up on today. It's from an Elgen size 18 7 jewel pocket watch. Now you can see the pivot hole that we'll be closing. Now that indention right there is called an oil sink, and that's where you place your oil when you're lubricating your pivot. So let's talk a little bit about the pivot. Your watch has gears in it, and those are called wheels in the watch trade. Now each one of those gears has a shaft that runs through it, and at the very tip of that shaft is called a pivot. Now the pivot is a special hardened steel, and it's also been highly polished to reduce friction. So here's the issue you have. You have the hardened steel on the pivot poking through the hole that's been drilled into the brass plate, which is a lot softer than the hardened steel. And guess what's going to happen over time? That hardened steel is going to wear the hole in that brass plate and make it larger as that gear continues to spin around. And this is usually caused by lack of lubrication or lack of cleaning and proper maintenance of the pocket watch. And the watchmaker also found on some new watches the pivot holes needed to be closed because they were improperly sized at the factory. So let's inspect that pivot hole that we're going to be working on under the microscope. The pivot hole itself looks pretty good. It's nice and round. It's not worn oblonged or egg-shaped. If that pivot hole was egg-shaped, we wouldn't be able to use that hole anymore. We would have to enlarge that pivot hole using a broaching tool. Then a special bushing would have to be fitted in that hole. Then a new pivot hole would have to be drilled in the center of that bushing. Something I do see is there's a burr around the edge of that pivot hole. The burr is a rough edge ridge of metal that is formed around the edge of that pivot hole, and it needs to be removed. That burr will interfere with the distribution of oil to the pivot. It's a good practice to inspect all your pivot holes for burrs and remove them. Let's inspect the backside of that pivot hole. Well, it looks pretty good. I see a little bit of a burr around the mouth of that hole from the wear of that pivot. But we'll take care of all that. Now it's time to choose the punches that we're going to be using to close this pivot hole. First tool I'm going to get is my round face solid punch. The round face punch you choose will rest in the oil sink. You want a punch that's a little smaller in diameter than the oil sink. The reason is you want your punch tip to rest on the bottom of the oil sink. That way it's resting on the metal around the pivot hole. Next we have to find a stump. And that stump has to fit inside that recess on the back of the plate. If a stump that is used is too large to fit inside that recess, the punch is going to drive that metal towards the recess and causing the pivot hole to be even larger and possibly reducing the inshake on your pivot. So my regular stumps are just too large to fit in that recess. So I'm going to have to come up with something different to use as a stump. Well, since my staking tool set is the inverto type, I can choose one of my punches and invert it and use it as a stump. Well, I found the perfect punch that I can use as a stump. It's the flat-faced solid punch. Yeah, fits perfectly in that recessed area, just like what we need to help support that bottom of that plate. That'll make a good stump. Before we work on that pivot hole, let's take a piece of pegwood and clean out any dirt that might be embedded in it. If you like these videos, subscribe to my channel and hit that like button. Also, check out my home channel page. The videos are organized into topics and subjects you might be interested in. Now we got to get our die plate centering punch, so we can use it to center up the holes in our die plate with our radial arm on our staking tool set. Well, once we got that centered up, we lock our die plate down. We invert our flat face punch that we'll be using as our stump. And then we take our plate and find that recess area, and we set that recess area on our stump, make sure it's centered up, and we lower our round nose punch into the oil sink, and we hold it there and get everything adjusted so everything's lined up. Now we keep a little bit of pressure on our round nose punch to push down on the plate, kind of holds it in place. We adjust everything so it's good and in alignment. Push down with two fingers on that punch. Take our brass hammer and a few light taps. So what we've done is we've condensed the metal between the punch and the stump when we hit it, and it moves that metal towards the hole, which it offers the path of least resistance, and that displaced metal makes the hole smaller. There's also another advantage in closing the pivot holes. The metal around the hole becomes harder because it's condensed, and it won't wear as fast as it did before from friction. Now we're going to check our pivot hole with our pivot, and it pivot should just barely enter that hole that we've closed. The hole is going to be too tight, and we're going to have to open the hole up a little bit so the pivot can rotate freely. Now to open the hole back up, we're going to be using this tool here. It's a round smoothing broach. Now they have other broaches that are called cutting broaches, but they're just a little bit too aggressive for what we're going to be using it for. So we need the round smoothing broach. Before we start using our broaching tool, we're going to put a little oil on the shaft of the broaching tool to reduce any friction, and it helps it not get bound up in that pivot hole as we're using the tool. Now you just take your oiled broach and you insert it in the pivot hole, and you turn in one direction, and you don't put a lot of pressure. You just barely turn and keep working and go slow. Don't get in a hurry, because if you make the hole too big, you mess it up and you'd have to do the whole process of closing that hole again. So you just take your time and work slow with it. Another important thing is you want to keep that broaching tool at an upright angle. You don't want to tilt it as you're doing the broaching, because that'll make your hole off center and it causes the pivot to pinch when it's turning. Now once you're done with the broaching process, you just take your pivot and check it and see if it slides in there nice and easy. This takes a little practice to get this down, but the more you do it, the better you get at it. And but you want it to fit in there nice and easy, but you don't want it too loose. Well, now we have our hole nice and broached out. There's another issue that we're going to have to deal with. By using the broaching tool, we've created a burr around the oil sink hole, and now we have to remove that burr. That burr will interfere with the distribution of the oil to the pivot. So it's going to have to be removed. Now what we're going to use is a countersink tool. And this is something that I made up from some parts that I had. I used an old reamer that I found in a box of parts that I had bought off eBay one time. And I thought, well, this will make a perfect tool for this job. And I just put the reamer in a pin vise and use that pin vise as a handle. So we're going to take our countersinking tool, and we're going to take our plate and place the countersink carefully into the oil sink. And then we're going to just twist it real gently. We don't push down hard, just light pressure of it. And that's going to remove that burr out of the oil sink and out of the pivot hole, so there won't be no problem with the oiling. Now we're going to do the back side and remove any burr that's on it too. So remember, just go slow, take your time, and do a good job. Now we're going to check our work again and see if that pivot still fits in there good, and it does. Now one more thing that we need to be aware of, and is that we could have changed the end shake on this pivot. So we'll have to check that. But that's going to be in a whole new video. I'll show how to adjust the end shake on these watches. Well, here's a before picture. You can clearly see that burr around the pivot hole. So one thing you want to be aware of when working on these low jewel count watches is to check those pivot holes for burrs. I've even read accounts where new watches from the factory had to have the burrs removed from them. Now here's the pivot hole after it's been made smaller. The burr has been removed from both sides of the pivot hole. The oil sink's been cleaned and polished with a piece of peg wood and a little bit of polishing compound to clean out any tool marks that might have been left over from the closing process with the punch. And the pivot fits in the new resized pivot hole like it should.